morning, family. How are you guys doing? We have an old member of our family here today.
Would you just call me old? What in the world? Oh, no, you didn't.
We are super glad to have Leonard here with us this morning. I know we've all missed him and his family, so it's a blessing to be able to worship with him this morning. If you guys want to stand with us and we can get into it.
Your faithfulness, your faithfulness. still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never seen it again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. Father of kindness, you have poured out grace. You brought me out of darkness, you have filled me with peace. Giver of mercy, you're my help in time of need. Lord, I can't help but sing. Promises are yes and amen. All your promises are yes and amen. Oh. Beautiful Savior, you have brought me. From the ashes, you have broken every curse. Blessed Redeemer, you have set this captive free. Lord, I can't help but sing.
Is your faithfulness, faithfulness.
says a yes and amen.
Amen. Second Corinthians 3:18 says, and we who with unveiled faces all reflect the Lord's glory, all being transformed in his likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Some translations saying being transformed from glory to glory. To go from glory to glory, to be ever-increasing in glory, is to continually be changed into what you were created to be. It is to be conformed to his likeness. It is increasing in the character and nature of God. So as we go into this next song, I just pray that the Holy Spirit would just be in us and work through us every single day. That we would just continue to be more and more like you, God.
Created from dust, you came and you lived among us. You took on our fame, you walked in our pain, and now you're taking us higher. You stepped into time, you laid down your life to save us. You took all our shame, you walked in, was laid, and now you're taking us higher.
We go from glory to glory to glory. We'll never be the same, we'll never be the same. We go from glory to glory to glory. We're forever changed, forever changed. From glory to glory to glory, we'll never be the same, we'll never be the same. We go from glory to glory to glory, and we're forever changed, forever changed, until we reach that day. Love conquers it. Glory to glory, we'll never be the same. never be the same. We go from glory to glory to glory. We're forever changed, forever changed. We go from glory to glory to glory. Never be the same, we'll never be the same. We go from glory to glory to glory. We're forever changed, forever changed. We go from glory, we go from glory to glory.
Anybody changed today? Amen. God bless you. You all may have a seat.
Hey, good morning, everybody. Good morning. Can you hear me? Okay. When I saw these two coming back, I thought about Peaches and Herb reunited. Too bad I can't sing that. But, you know, for the older ones, we know who Peaches and Herbs are. The youngest ones, don't worry about it. You know, that's when bell bottoms were out. But, it was all good. So good morning, everyone. On behalf of Carmel Christian Church, I'd like to welcome each and every one of you all here for attending today and online. Please don't forget to like us on Facebook and subscribe to our YouTube channel. One thing I want to let everyone know is I hope you brought your napkins, your bibs, your gloves. Huh? I brought my bib. You know, I brought my bib. Okay. I got stains on my shirt already? Okay, Mrs. Porter was at home, and I just happened to just touch the food, okay, a couple of times. I should have looked in the mirror, but I didn't, okay? So you know what today is? It's a tour of Italy. So today's a potluck, so definitely, hopefully each and every one of y'all can stay back and test the food that everyone brought. And do they give a award out? I think we get an award out. Yeah, so, you know, let's stand by because some people are very competitive. I won't say any names, but I can look at it around some people like my – yeah, okay, got it, Derek. Okay, I didn't say it. Somebody else in the audience said it. So it should be posted, the weekly events. If it's not, I'll just go through it real quick. Mondays, 6:30 to 8 p.m., we have Women's Ministry. All right. Zoom and in person, and it's Jeremiah, and it's, I wrote it down. I made sure I wrote it down. Jeremiah, daring to hope in an unstable world. Am I correct, Ms. Hudson? Roger that. Hey, it's always good to get a, you know, spell check together, you know. Also, when Pastor Ken was talking about Wednesday night, 7 to 8 p.m., we do have Bible study. Names of God is a really good time to get together outside the church and just sit down and just relax. Let your hair down. I don't have any, but it's no problem. Just let your hair down and just talk. Also, from 7 to 7:45, we have discipleship going on the same location. If you want to know, please, like Pastor Ken said, contact someone here, like Eric. It would be a good idea. Or if not, you can call the church, 858-538-4662, or go online at carmelmountain.com. Okay? Thursday, we have prayer in the sanctuary at 5 to 6 p.m. Also, Friday, we have Enough. Doors open at 6:30. So we have a whole bunch of things outside just coming in on Sundays. But the doors will always be open every Sunday at 10 a.m., okay? The same time when, you know, NFL, CBS, CNN, all of them are going on. We'll be still here worshiping, okay? All right. Let's pray for the offering. Almighty and gracious God, we pray for your blessing today as we come to give you our tithes and offerings. We ask that you would bless us in return. In your holy name, amen. Amen. Ways you can give, you can text GIVE to 833-535-0980, or you can give online at Carmel Mountain Church. The kiosk is up and running, so if you all like to use the kiosk, you can use it. Also, old-fashioned, if you want to use a basket, it's right by the door. Remember, we have these QR codes, so you can always scan your phone, take a picture, and you can give online. Remember, in the back, over there, by the kiosk and by the table, Invite to Rewrite. Get one of these cards on your way out. Put a stamp on it. It's only about 55 cents. And invite someone. Okay? Also, the last thing before I go is, has anybody really actually sat down and looked at that table? All that good information at that table? I walked by that table for probably about 2 years and didn't know. If it wasn't for Pastor Ken, you know, holding me up, and, you know, he wanted to say by 3 week challenge, I would have never sat there and looked at that. And it was a lot of good information. So if you can, go by there and stop by the table and just look. It's some good information out there. Okay? On behalf of Carmel Christian Church and online, we wish each and every one of y'all a blessed week.
This next song is called Defender. It's all about God defending us and defending our hearts and defending our minds and defending our souls. So if you're in a spot where you're anxious or you're stressed or you're tired or you're sick, just remember that God is there for you with his arms wide open to love you and comfort you and support you. So if you want to stand or sit through this next song, I just really want you guys to just meditate on the lyrics. You go before I know that you've even gone to win my war. You come back with the head of my enemy. And you come back and you call it my victory. Go before I know that you've even gone to win my war. Your love becomes my greatest defense. It leads me from the dry wilderness, and all I did was pray. me back together. You are the defender of my heart. And when I thought I lost me, you know where I left me. You reintroduced me to your love. You picked up all my pieces, put me back together. You are the defender of my heart. Sing when I lost. And when I thought I lost me, you know where I left me. You reintroduced me to your love. You picked up all my pieces, put me back together. You are the defender of my heart. Hallelujah, you have saved me. So much better your way. Hallelujah, hallelujah, great defender. So much better your way. Hallelujah, hallelujah, you have saved me. So much better. You reintroduce me to your love. You picked up all my pieces, put me back together. You are the defender of my heart.
Anybody feeling that this morning? Amen. Amen. The altar is open. We're going to take a little bit of time to pray before we go into the sermon message. So if you want to come up here to the altar, you can. If you want to stand, you can just stand there. If you want to kneel, you can do that. This is the time that we're going to corporately look to the Lord. Heavenly Father God, as I'm standing here, I'm thinking, Lord, how much you defend us, God. And sometimes you defend us, Lord, probably a lot more than we think. And we don't even know it. We don't even know that we need to be defended. You keep the enemy off of our doorstep and off our footstool. And many times, God, we ask you for things, Heavenly Father, God, and then we forget that we asked you. You answer the prayer, and we don't even come back and say thank you. But today we want to fix all that. Today we want to recognize who you are, Heavenly Father God, and how you move. And your invisible hand comes, and sometimes it's visible what it is that you're doing and how you're doing it in our lives. So today, God, we definitely have a thank you that's on our lips. First of all, we thank you for being God. Lord, there's so many people out there believing so many different gods and so many different religions, Heavenly Father, God, but we know in our hearts and in our mind and in our spirit, God, and for real, that there's only one true and living God. Not a statue, no, not in nature, not a tree, but a living God who acts and moves in behalf of this world and these people who he loves. God loves you. He loves you today. And I pray that, God, you would move in the people's lives, God, as only you know how. Lord, I talk to my wife and I talk to my children and I talk to people around me and they tell me what's going on. But God, I tell you, you know infinitely more than what they're saying. God, you know us better than we know ourselves. God, you hold the future, you hold the past, and you hold the presence right in your hand. And so to you, God, we commit all of those things this morning. starting with our very own lives, Lord. We recommit ourselves to you today. And we say, God, that we will follow you. Yes, God. Thank you, Jesus. We know as you're listening to us right now, God, and we recommit ourselves to you, I pray, Lord, that we would do something new, because we can definitely get into routines, Heavenly Father. We do this on Monday, we do this on Tuesday, we do this on Wednesday. But Heavenly Father, God, I pray that you would do something new, a new thing. God, that we wouldn't try to put old wine in new wineskins. But God, you would give us a new wine, Heavenly Father God, and we would do the new thing that you have for us to do in this time and season. In a dying world, God, a world that is all over the place, it is great to have the answer. And the answer is found in the name of Jesus. So we bless you today, God. We thank you for this time for us to join together as we corporately pray, as we worship with you. What a privilege and honor it is, God, to join in with the heavenly host, to join in and be able to praise you and honor you and say hallelujah to your name this morning. So we give all that to you because we love you and we praise you and we thank you, for it's in the name of Jesus. And if you agree with any of that, let the church then say, amen. Amen. How's everybody doing out there today? Good. I'm coming center stage now. So let me just say a couple things before we hear our message for today. Is actually this Wednesday we're starting a new Bible series. Now, what was really cool was last week we had been studying the names of God, and last week we took what we knew and we just prayed for each other and used all the different names for God. It was awesome just to be in that room, because we all say God and we all say Jesus, but we learned a lot of new names for God. It was awesome, and I think people were blessed. I know I was blessed by that. But on Wednesday, we're going to be starting a new series called New Age. Now, I have to tell you that this New Age, I'm going to recommend that everybody in here comes to and hears that, because Satan has infiltrated places you wouldn't even believe that he has. And he's done it through some of the New Age things and this New Age movements and religions and whatnot. And so this is going to be an invaluable Bible study for everybody. I'm even going to venture to say that some people are going to take their versions of the Bible and toss them, because you'll be surprised. So Wednesday, 7 o'clock, see Tom and Carla for the address. You want to come and join us? Come on, just come and take a sniff. You know, that's all you have to do. Come and take a sniff and see how it smells, and you may like it. And come in and taste and see that what's going on is good. So today we do have a speaker, because I'm not speaking today. You see I dressed all down and everything. I'm chilling, right? So we have a pastor, a minister in training, and his name is Eric Tholander, who is going to be speaking to you today. So without further ado, let me turn it on over to him. Come on up, Eric. Let me pray for you as you're getting ready to bring the word. Heavenly Father God, I pray for Eric messing with the cord. Don't worry about the cord. If you trip on it, we'll just laugh and keep on going. I pray, God, that you would bless him right now in the name of Jesus, Lord. He's done the studying. He's done the wood shedding, Lord, and now it's time to bring the word. So I pray that you would touch him. I pray that angels would be sitting right on his shoulders, just whispering to him what he should say, and meet us exactly where we are in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Wow, thank you guys for that really nice welcome. I literally pictured worship being almost that good, but not that good. That was amazing. Can we give them a hand? That was amazing. So there's that saying, be careful what you pray for. And before I got up here today, I prepared and I did all the stuff and I was practicing delivering it because I wanted to make sure that I did it right. And I made the mistake of asking all my friends to pray that Holy Spirit would take over. I'm joking, but Holy Spirit took over. And during worship, I was just being bombarded with Holy Spirit's goodness. It was amazing. So I just was kidding around to say, be careful what you pray for. I have a really good message for you guys today. It's really good. You're going to like it. I'm glowing right now. I don't know if you can tell, but it's because I've been spending time with him and he just reassured me and reaffirmed me before service even, I mean, before I got a chance to come up here and deliver this message to you. So I want to pray right now and I want to get on my knees and I was wondering if you guys can you get on your knees with me? All right. Yeah. Porter will help you. He benches 500 pounds, so he'll help you. Lord Jesus, I thank you for that worship. I thank you, Holy Spirit, that we don't have to ask you to come. You're always with us. We just have to ask you, help us be aware. And right now I am aware of you, and I believe other people in this room are aware of you. I just gave a friend a hug and she just wept because she is aware of your presence. You are here right now. I pray that you come and speak to every one of our hearts. We surrender everything to you. That's what that song says. It just says over and over, I surrender everything to you. Right now we're on our knees. We surrender to you. Bring this message to us, Lord, and touch our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, everybody help each other up, okay? So today I had a chance to meet our former worship leader, and it was amazing because he said, my son's name is Josiah, and I'm like, well, my son's name is Josiah, and he's like, he's 19. I'm like, my son's 19, and I wanted them to duel to the death so they could take over that name. But Josiah's tall and got the reach, but their son's buff, and I don't know, so I changed my mind on that one. I first wanted to tell you that there's a reason I'm here, and in the songs, all these songs that we sang today, over and over again, they were saying how God is faithful. God is there before you even get there. God directs and guides you where you got to go. And the title of my sermon is Lord Help Me. So I want you guys to help me. When I point to you, I want you to shout that. Lord, help me. Oh, you got to do better than that. Lord, help me. There we go. All right, this is going to be perfect. All right, so I know you guys have all had a Lord Help Me moment. Everybody had that? Has anybody had a Lord Help Me season?
Yeah.
Okay. Some of you might be in a Lord Help Me season right now. I'm not. These tears that you saw me have shedding during worship are just tears of total joy because I'm just glowing in his presence right now. But I've been there. And in this season that I had of Lord Help Me, I went to a house where I was leading worship. And this lovely, beautiful woman comes in named Linda. And she sees that there's some turmoil going on in my soul, my spirit. And I tell her I'm a little turmoil because somebody can't turn off their cell phone. Just kidding. So I'm in a little turmoil and I'm like kind of being pulled between what I think, I thought I was a worship leader, but then I'm discovering maybe I'm not. And I'm being woken up at 3 o'clock in the morning, year after year after year after year, with these sermons, and they're good. You know, they need work, some of them, but I'm like, why is God doing that? Where are you pulling me? What are you telling me? And Linda comes over and says, you need to meet my husband. He was a worship leader and now he's a pastor. So she invited me to this church and I'm here today because of Linda. Thank you, Linda. Yeah, please. And then when I get here, I get recruited by Brooke because she finds out that I'm a guitar player and she speaks life into me and I find out I am a worship leader. I'm a good one. I love the Lord and I'm willing and that's all he wants. And so I come up here and I get to lead worship with her. I met her brother Andre and Rachel. They prayed over me and spoke life into me. And then I met their sister Kelsey and her husband Ryan prayed for me and spoke life over me. And then during that whole time I got to meet Pastor. Do you remember my first impression with you, Pastor? Thank God. I'll tell you what it was. So, Brooke has a son named Zion. He has this gorgeous bronze skin, this hair of Samson, but it could go, women want his hair. And when I saw him, I looked at Brooke and I said, wow, your daughter has beautiful hair. And Pastor comes in, that's not her daughter, that's her son. And that was it. And I'm like, note to self, you just made the worst impression with the pastor. You were looking forward to meeting him, then just telling you're going to meet him and all this other stuff. Well, praise God, you don't remember that. But I want to talk about pastor for a second, and I want to tell you that sometimes people go, you're called, and you don't answer the call. And when he introduced me last time, he said, sometimes people go, I can't hear you. I was answering the call so much that I was asking people to mentor me, and I was getting no's, and I'm already mentoring this guy, and not right now, or this isn't the right season. And people didn't really necessarily say no, they'd just be like, you know? And so I felt that a lot, and I was like, gosh, I know something's going on in my life and my spirit, and I need somebody that's willing to spend the time to do this. And Pastor came to me one day and he goes, what are you gonna do about that call? And I'm like, what are you talking about? And he's like, you're getting woken up at 3 o'clock in the morning. I told him that. And he's like, you get in these sermons and you can't sleep and you think about it all day long. And every time you meet somebody, there's this call on you. What are you doing about it? And I'm like, nothing, praying, you know? So he said, I'm gonna take you under my wing. I'm gonna put you in the school of the servant. And what Jesus sees in me, Pastor, you see in me. Thank you. So I just want to say thanks for that. All right. There you go. So, Lord help me can be like we did earlier. Lord help me can be in your car. Lord help me can be bawling on your bed at night. Lord help me could be something, you got a smile on your face when you're saying it. It's a very important thing to say. I want to tell you the scripture that goes with the worship that we just did right now. It's my first scripture, and it's Psalm 139, verse 8. And that, in the King James Version, says, if I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. I love this, because it's a no-brainer if we ascend into heaven, God's there, right? That's a no-brainer, right? But if we are in hell, we're thinking, oh, that's eternal, God's not there. But this scripture that David's talking about, I believe he's saying, if I'm going through hell on earth, right? You're there. God, you're there. But my favorite part about that is it says, if I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. Please don't let me be alone. Raise your hand if you have ever made your bed in a hellish situation. Okay, we're not the only ones. We're going to read about it right now. Let's turn in our Bibles to Jesus, to Genesis 16:9. Let's turn to Jesus. Genesis 16:9. And before we do that, there was a saying that I came up with, I felt God gave me in regards to that scripture. And when I point to you, you say, Lord, and I say to you, Daddy sees you. Jesus frees you. Holy Spirit will never leave you. If you learn anything from this message today, this is why I'm so excited. This is why I'm going. I know that. I am 100% convinced of that. My friend Doug's in the back. He knows me. He knows I know that. Pastor knows me. Linda knows me. You guys in here know me. You know that I know that. And there's some times where I need to be encouraged in that. A lot of times I need to be encouraged in that. But I walk in that. So when people say, practice what you preach, that's not what I'm doing. I'm preaching what I already practice. Not because I'm so cool, but because I know he loves me. He sees me, he freed me, and Holy Spirit will never leave me. And I'll tell you one thing real quick. When I was going to the bathroom to wipe my face and just get ready to come out here, I was saying like, hey, if I go over here real quick, maybe Holy Spirit will stop attacking me with goodness and, you know, weeping and all this other stuff. And he's just following me. And I'm, you know, it's like I'm going to the bathroom and he's just, everywhere I go, he's just loving on me. And I remember being on stage one time in worship, not at this church, but another one. And I was playing guitar and I just started bawling. And it's my gift. That's my awesome gift. Don't get envious. I cry and, you know, tears, snot, all that kind of stuff, right? In front of people. It's awesome. So I'm up there and I'm playing guitar and I'm like, stop, stop it. Like, please stop. And his goodness is all over me and I'm weeping. And then I caught myself. Catch yourself if this ever happens to you. And I caught myself and I said, no, don't stop this. Take not your Holy Spirit from me. That's what David prayed. He knew what it was like to have Holy Spirit leave him. We will never know what that's like. Because if you've asked Jesus in your heart, and I'm only gonna give you a chance at the end of this message to do that, if you haven't, but if you guys know that have asked Jesus in your heart, you've accepted that invitation, you know that you receive Holy Spirit right away. I did that at 7 years old in 1979. Yes, I'm old. And right away, I was on my face weeping before the Lord. And at 7 years old, what kind of stresses are you having, right? I grew up in a nice family. I didn't have stresses. They were tears of joy. So when I tell you Holy Spirit will never leave you, that's a promise I'm not making. That's in the Word. In Genesis 16:9, we're going to talk about that first part of that right there. In Genesis 16:9, it says, "The angel of the Lord said to her, 'Return to your mistress and submit to her.'" Have you guys heard the story of Hagar? Okay, so I'm going to start off with Abram and Sarai. Abram and Sarai are promised that they are going to have a child. It is a promise. And not only is it a promise that they're going to have one child, it says the descendants of this child will be more than the stars in the sky or the sand in the sea. You won't be able to count them. It's a huge promise. And at this point, Abram's 86 years old and Sarai is 76 years old. And she stops trusting God, or she's kind of helping God along. Has anybody done that? You get a promise from the Lord and you're going to just kind of help the Lord along your way. I'm the only one that's done that. Okay. I guess I'm the only one that's done that. God promised me I was going to be a father when I was young. I'd be babysitting kids and everybody would say, you're so great with kids. You're going to be a great father someday. And I'm like, yeah, that would be cool. I mean, we're talking 9 people are telling me this. And Josiah will tell you, or I'll put him in a headlock, I'm a great father. But really, that's just something I dreamed of since a kid. So I got married too quick. I married the wrong person. She married the wrong person, being me. So I'm not talking smack on her. We just got married too quick. I actually did that twice. I got married too quick twice. And I was trying to scoot this whole process along for God because he promised that I was going to have somebody. And he promised I was going to have children. Well, this is a story about, like, my children, Asia, Delilah, and Josiah. God took what I tried to rush along, and he made something beautiful out of it. 3 things beautiful out of it. In this case, it's Hagar. She is told by Sarai, go sleep with my husband. She tells her husband, Abram, go sleep with my maidservant, and I'm going to have a kid through her. She doesn't trust God. She's going to help him along. And then Sarai despises her, and she sends her away. You guys can read this in the chapter of 16th chapter of Genesis. She sends her away. And what I love about this is the intimacy between our daddy and Hagar, who's sent away. The angel of the Lord says, go back and submit to her. The reason why I wanted to write that scripture out of the whole story out is because I've been told by the Lord, and I don't know if you guys have been told by the Lord, but I've been told, go back to that situation that's kind of garbagey and stay there. And I'm not telling anybody here, if they're in an abusive relationship, to stay in that marriage. I'm not telling them to leave that marriage. You got to pray. You got to seek the Lord. You got to get godly counsel. But there are times when a woman is in, for example, is in an abusive relationship, and a man, and you got to get out. That's not what I'm telling you here. What I'm telling you is she is told by the Lord, go back to your abusive boss. In the Message Bible, it says, go put up with that abuse. And so go back and put up with your boss. And then what I love about this is if you see there's a promise there and you skip down after the promise of her having a son who's going to be named Ishmael, and he will have more descendants that can be numbered. You get to verse 13, and verse 13 in Genesis chapter 16 says, she called the name of Yahweh who spoke to her, you are the God who sees me. What I love about Hagar is she is not going, I can't believe I got to go back to this bad situation, or I was almost, you know, starved to death out in the desert. She could have felt sorry for herself. Instead, she's like, God sees me. I mean, how incredible is that? She could have completely focused on the bad situation. Instead, she said, God sees me. The next definition, if you can put up there, is El Roy. El Roy means the God who sees me. Has God ever been El Roy to you? Okay, I just gave you an example about how he was El Roy to me. I was going through something, then I go to this house to lead worship, and I don't even think I'm a worship leader, and then I find out I am a worship leader, and then I find out I'm called to be up here and deliver this message of amazing love that the Father has for us, for you right now. So thank you, Lord. So, Lord, help me. Daddy sees you, Jesus frees you, and Holy Spirit will never leave you. If you guys can turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 15, verse 25. And that verse says, but she came and knelt before him, saying, Lord, help me. She said exactly those three words. The reason why she said those three words is she was chasing Jesus down. And if you look up the history on this, this passage is amazing. This woman is not a Jew. Jesus is Jewish, and he's coming to the chosen people first. Later, I will tell you, if you just hear this message, this part of the message, make sure you hear this. Jesus came for everybody. He first came for the Jew. He paid the highest price, died, and rose again on the third day, and everybody gets to be in his family. The cool thing I like about this is I get to call him his adopted child. And I just want to talk about that real quick. I was just somewhere with Pastor recently at a pastor's convention, and I ran into an old friend who's a pastor, and I remember something he told me one time. He said that one of his adopted children came to him and said, one of his biological children was making fun of him and said, you're adopted. And this pastor said something so precious. He said, I'm going to put that kid on restriction for 3 months. No, I'm just kidding. he said that, he goes, your mom and I looked everywhere for you. We went through countless paperwork. We drove out to find you. And we had to wait this long, long process. And he goes, we chose you. I'm stuck with him. But we chose you. And he went back and loved on his other son. And you know what I mean? But I just thought that was so cool because I'm like, wow, you chose me. Daddy sees you. Jesus frees you and Holy Spirit will never leave you. He chose you. He chose me. So the story of this one is a Gentile who's Canaanite, who's Syrophoenician, who's Greek, who's Lebanese. And the area that she comes from is Tyre and Sidon. I don't know if I'm saying it right, but that is actually the area where Jezebel convinced everybody to worship Baal, Satan. And it doesn't have a really good history behind it at all. And it didn't end very well for Jezebel. I don't know if you know the story, but it was prophesied she'd be thrown off a balcony and dogs would rip her pieces. She was a horrible, horrible, evil woman, and the prophecy came true. So that's the memory that everybody has of that area, or at least these guys have of that area. And she's chasing Jesus down. And when she chases Jesus down, she says, Son of David, have mercy on me. She knows who he is. There are Jews that are with Jesus. They don't even know who he is. They haven't got it yet. But she knows who he is. Something's going on here. And she heard that Jesus has the power to cast out demons. So she says, heal my daughter. My daughter's possessed and there is no hope. Has anybody seen the Chosen series? Yes. It's so wonderful. It's biblical. It follows every scripture of the Bible. But there is a little added part to the backstory of each of these disciples, not to Jesus, not to the message of the gospel, but to these disciples. And I love it because it paints a picture of total hopelessness. And it's like hopelessness meet hope. It's amazing. Hopelessness, come here, I want you to meet somebody. Hope, capital H, capital O, capital P, capital E. It doesn't say that we put our hope in God. It says God is our hope. It says we will receive in Romans 5, 3 through 5. It says we glory in tribulation, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, knowing that perseverance produces character, and character leads us to hope, not hope of the world that disappoints, but hope from the Holy Spirit that's been poured out by the love of God. So, yes, amen to that. You guys want to say amen? Because it's true. All right. So this woman, this Syrophoenician woman, I'm just going to call her Syrophoenician because I can't pick which one of the five I want to pick. But she's Syrophoenician, and she comes before the Lord, and she knows that he is hope, and her situation is hopelessness. So she comes before him, and you know what he does? He just keeps walking. She's behind him. I had to read this story like 6 times before I got it. I could not stand seeing that side of my Jesus who I love. He's my best friend. I couldn't stand seeing that. But God kept saying, keep reading it. Keep reading. I'm going to reveal something to you. I'm going to reveal something to you really precious. Why don't you do the math for me? Because you like math, Eric. You like numbers, right? Does anybody else like numbers? Okay, so I did the math on it. From Gennesaret, I don't know if I'm saying it right, the last place Jesus was at to go to Tyre was 40 miles, approximately 40 miles. To go from Tyre to Sidon, and I don't know if it went to Sidon first and Tyre, but I was just doing the math, it's 22 miles. And then from Tyre and Sidon to Galilee, it's 35 miles. If you add those up, that's 97 miles. Let's just round up to 100 miles. Do you guys really think that Jesus walked on foot with his whining disciples 100 feet? I mean, seriously, right? Do you think he walked 100 feet to turn his back on her and just keep walking from her? Why would somebody walk 100 miles to turn their back on somebody? He was poking her. And when I say poking, like poking the bear, poking somebody to wrestle, right? And he was agitating her. My son does that with me all the time. And he just has tons of energy. I love him. And I pretend, I'm like, don't do it, because I'm one of these days I'm going to take you, but I'm getting to the point where he's 19 and he's strong, and I don't know if I can take him, so just keep that on the down low. So here's the thing. She comes to Jesus again after he ignores her, and then she says, Lord, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus says, I didn't come for you. I came for the chosen children. I came for the Jews. And she's like, Lord, I need your help. My daughter is demon-possessed, and no one can help me. I'm adding stuff in there because it doesn't say all that in the scripture, but I'm going to imagine she really went off. And he's like, should I give the food that's for the children to the dogs? And I love this part. This part, we got to read this together. I didn't put it up there, but it's Matthew 15, and I think it's verse 27. So just give me a second to catch up to you guys. If you have your Bibles, it's Matthew 15, verse 27. And she said, yes, Lord. Like, you're right, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. Wow. The story is not about Sarai and Abram, it's about Hagar. God sees you, Hagar. God sees you. God sees me. And this story right here is about Jesus saves me and God the Father sees you. He sees her, but she's got to make herself known. It's more for the disciples, and 2,000 years later, it's more for us. It wasn't that Jesus wasn't going to heal her daughter. It was just like, I want this to be a message for 2,000 years and on, for everybody to know they come boldly before the throne. You can come boldly before Daddy's throne. You can come boldly to Jesus. You can come boldly with Holy Spirit, and you can say, help me. Lord. Right? You can say that. So what does Jesus say? He answered her and said, oh woman, great is your faith. Be it done for you as you desire. And her daughter was healed instantly. Isn't that cool? Can we just clap to that right now? Like 2,000 years later? That's awesome. And what happens when hopelessness meets hope? Hopelessness is gone. It gets destroyed. And hope overcomes. So Daddy sees you. Jesus frees you. Holy Spirit will never leave you. I want to change that so we can make it real personal. And you guys can say it with me if you would, please. Daddy sees me. Daddy sees me, Jesus frees me, Holy Spirit will never leave me. Say that again. Daddy sees me, Jesus frees me, please don't forget that. Whatever you learn out of the scriptures I just read, or my heart to come up here and serve, or the worship today, or what Pastor prayed, whatever you walk away with today, please don't forget that. And some people have a little problem, or maybe they're just uncomfortable with the part that says, Daddy. I'm going to read you a scripture that gives you full authorization to call Yahweh Daddy, which is amazing. So I'm going to look up the definition of, actually, before I look up the definition of this next word real quick, I want to tell you that there's a guy named Pheidippides. Pheidippides is the one who went from Marathon to Athens in 490 BC. And that trek was about 40 kilometers. So that's where the term marathon comes from. The problem with this marathon is he ran this marathon and then dropped dead. Okay? So if you see anybody that runs marathons, give them a hand and have respect, because it's hard to do. I will never run a marathon, but I'm not looking down upon it. Mary Beth is an endurance athlete, and I cannot keep up with her. That's pretty incredible. But the reason I brought it up is if you looked at the math of the distance Jesus went to tell that girl that Daddy sees her and Jesus freed her daughter of the demons, that was like four marathons. And he didn't run them, but he was walking there to do that. So just remember that. Pheidippides, marathon. If you're not trained for it, you could do a marathon and drop. Don't do it. All right, so freedom. We're looking up the definition of freedom. Something is free if it can change easily and is not constrained in its present state. Something, I'm going to put this and make it more personal. Someone is free if they can change easily and are not constrained to their personal state. That is freedom. That's what happens when you come to Jesus. right? That's freedom. Can you guys say amen to that so it sounds cool? All right, cool. Romans 8:15, because of Jesus, I throw this in here because there's a whole story on Romans 8. Romans 8 is an amazing chapter. If you get a chance to put a verse in there to memory, it'll change your life. If you can somehow memorize the whole chapter, I'm working on that right now. There's scripture after scripture after scripture. My buddy Doug has that thing memorized. But I got this verse memorized, and I'm pretty proud of myself for that because it's amazing. Because of Jesus, we have no longer received a spirit of bondage, again, to fear. You could put in parentheses there anything that Jesus will free you of. So you could put, you've no longer received a spirit of bondage again to lies said about you from your childhood, from the enemy himself, even your own mind. I have a friend who said there's a committee in there. And this committee is just not on your side. Jesus is, Holy Spirit is, but sometimes this committee just overpowers that voice. God's voice a lot of times is still and small. And these voices that are lying are so loud. So if you're hearing, if you're dealing with shame, you have no longer received a spirit of bondage again to shame. If you're dealing with any kind of addiction, it doesn't have to be drugs. It could be pornography. It could be just an addiction to loving money. It could be, you could make anything in your life an idol, and that could be your addiction. So Holy, you no longer received a spirit of bondage again to addiction. You no longer received a spirit of bondage again to pain. If there's emotional pain going on in you or physical pain, Jesus says you're set free from that. I don't know why some people are healed right away and some people aren't, but he promises in his word that you keep claiming his promises. He says that you will be healed of that emotional pain. He says that you'll be healed of your physical pain. So the rest of the scripture says, instead, you've received a spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Daddy, Father. I looked up the synonyms for Abba. I've told you guys this before, and it says everything from Papa, Padre, Daddy, whatever name you want to call him, you get to call him because Jesus paid the highest price. Jesus didn't die on the cross for us. He rose again 3 days later. That's why you get to call him Daddy. That's why I'm excited to deliver this message to you. Okay, and we're going to get into the last part, why Holy Spirit will never leave you. If you guys turn in your Bibles to Romans 23, verse 19, it says, God is not a man that he should lie, nor a son of man that he should repent. He has said, and will he not do? He has spoken, and will he not make it good? So he can't lie. If you turn to, I don't have it up here, but if you turn to Malachi 3:6, God says, I am the Lord, and I do not change. If you go into the New Testament and you read in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5, it says, the Holy Spirit says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And then in Hebrews 13, verse 8, it says, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God can't change. If he promises something, he can't go back on his word. That would be lying. He would have to repent. He doesn't do that. So I just want to tell you those scriptures because they will reinforce what we're going to read next. I want to read a whole passage with you. I just put up a single verse, but if you could turn in your Bibles to John chapter 14, verse 15. The one I have up there is 16. It says, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter that he may abide with you forever. Remember when I pointed to you, what do you say? Lord, help me. In this version, English Standard Version, it actually says that Holy Spirit is our helper, which is pretty cool. I'm still turning here myself. Did anybody bring a paper Bible today? Am I the only one? Everybody's got them on their phone. That's cool. That's fine. Okay, so I'm going to start with verse 15. Jesus promises the Holy Spirit, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. He will not leave you as orphans. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you yet a little while, and the world will see me no more. But you will see me, because I live, you also will live. And that day you will know that I am in my Father, Daddy, and you in me, and I in you. Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. Then Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus answered, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my word, and the word that you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. These things I have spoken to you while I'm still with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I am going away and I will come to you. If you loved me, you would have rejoiced because I'm going to Daddy. For the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it takes place, so that when it does take place, you may believe. I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. He has no claim on me. But I do as the Father has commanded me, so that the world may know that I love the Father. Rise, let us go from here. I put a different voice on that, he has no claim on me, because I want you guys to know, some people think that Jesus and Satan are equals. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Just so you know, we're humans, there's angels, and then way, way, way up there is Holy Spirit, Jesus, the Father, as far as the power chain going on, as far as like the hierarchy. So if you were to think of, my son loves boxing, if you were to think of a boxing ring, and you were to think of an arena in that boxing, around that boxing ring, the devil and his little demons, they're not even allowed to go into that arena to try and fight Holy Spirit or Jesus or the Father. Jesus, sorry about that. Jesus, he actually allowed Satan to do what he had to do for us, so he could die, right, rise again three days later, and give us salvation. But I tell that to people because I don't know if you've ever seen, there's a pretty cool Carmen video, and it says in the Carmen video, that shows in the Carmen video that Jesus and Satan are in a boxing ring. It's actually pretty well done. And Satan takes Jesus down for the count, and it's just a reenactment of when Jesus goes to the grave, right? Has anybody seen this? Okay, well, it's pretty cool, because when he's down, Jesus is on the ground, and he's like totally falling on the ground, and then the counter, instead of saying 1, 2, goes 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, and Jesus starts getting up, and you can imagine what Satan's feeling, what the demons are feeling. They're terrified. Wait, why is it going backwards? Why is it going backwards? Because it's not a count till the victory. It's not finalized. That's just a countdown to where he gets up again. Now you're in big trouble. And he gave us that authority. So he went through this, and I love that he just puts it in there real quick. Jesus says, and he has no claim on me, like, make it known. I'm doing this willingly for you guys. Satan's not overpowering me. The darkness doesn't win in the end. The light always outshines the darkness. We were just at that meeting I was talking about with pastors, and one of the guys at the table, he's a pastor, and he says, stop cursing the darkness and just flip the light switch on. And I was like, ooh, that's good, right? Yeah, that was not mine. Yeah, I can't remember the pastor's name, but it was pretty cool. So I thought, sometimes in my room, and I got the blind shut and everything else, and it, even if it's during the day, I'm trying to keep it cool in there. And there's stuff going on in my house that's you know, just a struggle. And Jesus says, flip the light switch on. And I flipped it on a couple times this morning, actually. I got up early, and I was just experimenting with that. Like, really visualize this, Eric. And I just kept flipping it on, and I felt like Holy Spirit was, do it again. And I flipped it on, and I was like, wow, it's that simple. The light is in us. I'm going to wrap it up with this. I want to give you guys an invitation. In Revelation 3, chapter 3, verse 20, it says, Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone hears me and opens that door, I will come into him and dine with him and he with me. You guys get that? Yes. We get to have a meal with Jesus, like forever, right? And this invitation is open to anyone. So anybody watching online, anybody that's here right now, if I could have Brooke, excuse me, if I could have you guys come back up here and do worship, it'd be awesome. I want to give you this invitation right now, and I want you to just repeat after me. This is the best decision you'll ever make in your life. This is the most important prayer you'll ever pray in your life. So you can stay right where you are, and in your seats or at home when you're listening online, and even if you're listening to this message way later, it's not real time on the earth. It's kingdom time, and it doesn't reflect whatever year it is when you're listening to this. It doesn't affect whatever time of day it is. It doesn't even reflect what's going on in your life, your circumstances. It is an open invitation, and it's good anytime, anywhere. So I'm offering it to you right now. Jesus is offering it to you right now, and I just will have you repeat after me. Lord Jesus, Forgive me for all of my sin. Help me repent and turn from my old life to follow you. I want to have a relationship with your Father so I can call him my Father. I want to be able to call him Daddy or Abba. And I want you to be my Lord, Jesus. I want you to guide my life. Holy Spirit, I want you to come and be with me. And I invite you to never leave me. And I pray this in Jesus' name, amen. Oh, that's awesome. If we had a drummer today, I would have him beat on the snare right now, but can we just do a clap for, okay, good. Thank you, Jesus. So right now I was talking to you about heaven, and I want to tell you something that happens in chapter 3. It's amazing. In chapter 3, this song actually that we're going to do right now talks about how the Lord brings to us the head of our enemy, and we didn't earn it. And I want to tell you something that happens in Revelation that we didn't earn. In that same chapter where you just got an invite from Jesus, it says, Jesus says, to him who overcomes, and we didn't overcome, it was actually Jesus, but we get the credit for it. To him who overcomes, to her who overcomes at the end, I'm going to clothe them in this beautiful garment, a priceless garment. I can't describe it because John just kind of gave the description that he had, but nobody really knows what it looks like. It's something out of this world. And this is the best part. It's hard to say this part because it's too good to be true. It says that Jesus will look over at the Father. And he'll say your name before the Father in heaven. He said he will confess your name before the Father in heaven. There's nothing greater than that. He'll confess your name before all the angels. And he'll say, this is the one I've been telling you about, Daddy. This is the one I've been praying for their faith not to fail. This is the one I told you they're going to overcome. I told you they're going to overcome. This is the one I was knocking on their door of their heart in 2021. And I was saying, I want to come in. This is the one that let me in. That's what you're a promise. There's so many more promises in Revelation. One says that you're going to get a name written on you that only you will know. It'll be written on a pillar, and only you will know this name. So I want to pray one more prayer while this music's going. And I want to encourage you guys that already have Jesus in your heart. You already have Holy Spirit. Maybe you don't know you can call the Father, Daddy. Maybe you don't know you can call him Abba. Or maybe you know, but you don't feel worthy. Or you're battling an addiction. Or you have fear. You're just afraid. Or you've been hearing lies that you're not enough. Or you feel pain, emotional pain that just you don't think will ever go away. You're in a hopeless situation, even as a man of God, even as a woman of God, you're in a hopeless situation. There is that verse in Romans 8:15 that is your verse. It's not mine. It's all of our verses. We can claim it. It says you no longer received a spirit of bondage to anything. I'm very passionate about this because I don't like to see my friends in bondage to anything. I know what bondage is like. So Lord, I'm going to just have these precious sheep of yours, and I'm one of them, to pray this prayer, Lord, so we can be free. Lord Jesus, we can all pray it. Lord, I confess to you my bondage. And it could be in your head, to fear, to addiction, to pain, to lies, to shame. Lord, I confess that bondage to you. Break that bondage, Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit, by the blood you shed on the cross. I want to be right with you, and I want to walk in full authority with you. I receive all of your authority over serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. I pray this in Jesus' name.
If you gave your life to Christ today, we'd like to celebrate with you. Please text SAVED to 833-535-0980. We believe it's important to stay connected, so please text CMC Connect to 833-535-0980 and we will reach out to you. Thank you for joining us and have a blessed day.
Still in your hands, this is my comfort.